time at Heather for Rise Networks, and I submitted a proposal for this pop, not because I consider myself a puppet expert, I consider myself sort of a medium puppet user, but I know there's a lot of people using Puppet, and so I wanted there to be a place where we could all come together and talk about how everybody's using it, and potentially work on collaboration for Puppet module recipes and other things like that. So this is a bop, I hope to facilitate it, but really I want the people in the audience to share their experiences and wisdom on using Puppet. So I thought first thing, well first I want to ask a couple questions. First is, how many people in the room are using Puppet? Retained? That's pretty good, maybe a third. I guess other people in the room, are there other people in the room that are here to learn about what Puppet is? So I think maybe at first we can talk a little bit about what Puppet is, and maybe actually the best way to do that is to have people talk about what they're using Puppet for, and then other people with a better understanding of how it works. But Puppet is basically a framework for a lot of people compare it with CF Engine, although it's slightly different than that. But it's a framework for maintaining state on a whole bunch of machines in an automated way. Kind of thing that you would deploy once you had enough machines that it made more sense to do it centrally and less work. Although in some regard, it could be just as much work, but one thing that's really nice is that it gives you a lot of repeatability and the ability to deploy systems and that sort of thing. So so I think we have mics out there. Why don't we go ahead and have some people who are using Puppet in your name and your organization, and as much as you're willing to share about what you're using Puppet for and what your computing environment is like. Bill, you guys have mics?
Yeah.
I'm using Puppet at Trinity College in Melbourne for only about 6 hours. When we started to get into Puppet, I decided that because we had some old machines that we would just use it on a new machine and use it for everything on that machine. I found that with Puppet, it's best to ease into it because it's quite complicated, and that's the approach we've taken other people. Just ease into it by managing one thing at a time.
And are you... are these mostly servers or?
They're all servers.
All servers, okay.
Keith O'Brien, I work at RGA, it's a media company, and we're using it to manage 4 mail servers at this time, and it's to build it from bare metal up with just Core, Debian, and Puppet installed. And we take the same approach as him. It's quite a ramp up to get started, and it just started with a Honeypot mail server and eventually replaced all mail servers with Puppet.
Hi, my name is Brian Gupta. I work for a system administration consulting company. We, at this point, we pretty much use Puppet to manage 95% of everything. We're probably managing 150 plus VMs using Puppet. Currently, the only major thing that we're not using Puppet to manage is MySQL itself. Within the database itself, but users, packages, config files. Pretty much everything other than that and application code that's deployed to these servers is useful.
Russ Holder, Stanford University. We have been using Puppet from before Puppet had overrides. We can just Luke to add them because he didn't think he needed them originally. We manage all of our core computing infrastructure that runs on Unix with Puppet, for there, it's rare for there to be more than about 5 systems that are the same.
Is that for desktops?
No, we don't use Puppet at all for desktops. University means that managed desktops are mostly a theoretical concept.
Hi, my name is Evan Lambosis. I'm working at the Greek Research Technology Network, and we are using Puppet to manage all of our servers, at least we some core stuff like application and some core configuration files, and we're using for most of our services as well. And also, this is not my work, but DSA, the Daniel System Administrators, they use Puppet as well.
Hi, my name is Rohit. I work at the University of Connecticut. I'm managing about 50 servers and 50 workstations, and we're not currently using Puppet, but I'm very interested in learning about it.
That's everybody for now. So one of the things that I've come to realize when using Puppet is that before I'm going to deploy a new service and I want to start writing Puppet recipes for it, the first thing I do is I go out and I Google to see if anybody else has done this. And that's one way of finding things. And so if it doesn't already exist, I try and write it and do that. I wanted to kind of ask people what things did you run into that you needed to write either just Puppet recipes for, or have you written more generic modules that that you could use to deploy services? And does anybody want to talk about some of the stuff they've done with Puppet?
I mean, I can say something. We've been using it for long enough that unfortunately when we started at Stanford, there really wasn't a lot in the out there. So we kind of wrote most of it ourselves. Which means that a lot of it is very specific to how we do things. There's the old statement from the Mythical Man Month that turning code into a product takes 3 times as long, and turning a product into something you can ship is a matter of 3 times as much time. So one of the things that we're missing right now is how we take a lot of that stuff and share it in a better fashion with other people and kind of detangle it from all the stuff that we've written internally. But we're managing just about everything with it. So we at one point or another configured about any kind of server you can think of. It's mostly not particularly well in terms of thinking through the whole process, but everything from MySQL Server to LDAP servers, Kerberos, KDCs, they're all managed in Puppet.
Sorry, I'm late. I'm Antoine. I work with Kubit, and we've been using Puppet for about 2 years. And basically, one of the things I've always struggled with is to avoid word duplication. And so we're working on creating Puppet modules that can be reused by others. So creating the Apache module or the whatever module to manage whatever you want. Unfortunately, we lack the time to properly do that, as you said, because it's pretty hard to share those things. But Puppet is one of the cool things about Puppet is that it makes it much easier than other systems to share those things because the syntax is readable, it's kind of easy to learn, so you can pretty quickly figure it out and start using it. What we're doing is trying to create a common set of packages that these documents where all the modules are on the Puppet wiki. So if you guys are looking for something to manage any piece of infrastructure, whether it is LDAP or whatever, there's already a bunch of people that have published that list of modules and
My name is Jeff Crompton again. Like Russ, at my organization, we've written a lot of our own manifests. And to some extent, I think that that's not a bad idea, maybe in your first time, Grant, because you do have to learn the syntax to some extent. Just this last couple of weeks, I started using two cases of other people's modules. So to some extent, you've got to write your own manifest. And in one case, I'm using someone else's Varnish module, and then I'm writing my own module to extend it, to customize it to our needs.
In Ryzen, our workflow has generally been, when we're first starting a closed service, you write a very generic recipe that does nothing more than just copying a couple files or some things like that, and gradually over time it grows. But it's always kind of organization specific for a while until it gets to the point where it's like, you know, this would really be nice if this part was generic. And then we usually end up splitting it into a generic module and a site specific module, or just a site specific class. We make the generic module such that you can set variables to do different things that would be site specific, and then you have a site specific class that you plug those things in and call a generic one, and that's kind of how things have been calling. Okay.
I think, first of all, answer the question that you asked, Matt, was like, what are some interesting things that you're doing with Puppet? And I think two of the most useful things that we've started to do with Puppet that people don't always realize is possible is that we're auto-configuring Nagios and Munin whenever we set up a machine, so we're not having a laborious process of configuring Nagios for every single machine that we're setting up. They're actually quite easy now with the Nagios module and the Munin module. Not to say there aren't improvements that we've made, but this has changed the fact that I no longer have RSI to type these long configuration files, which is great. So those two things I think have been a big win for me. But to go back to the way the thread was going about the modules and sharing the modules and that sort of thing, we've written quite a number of different modules, and we're trying to move most of our internal infrastructure to using as much modules as possible. The hard part with writing modules, as people probably discovered, is that it's hard not to hard code some of your infrastructure into a module. And if a module is going to be shared amongst other people outside of your internal infrastructure, where you have your own policies and all kinds of weird IDs and routing or whatever it is that you have written in some sort of abstracted way that is useful for people who are not inside your infrastructure. And that's really hard to wrap your head around and think of, and when you're trying to just get something working for your infrastructure, it's sometimes easier to just do your particular configuration. So the way we've been starting to move towards standardizing is having abstracted modules, but then having site local modules that do some of the individual local changes that we wouldn't otherwise put into a public module. So that way we have some of the abstracted configuration, but then we also have some of our local configuration separated in the module format so that we can share the module with other people, the public one, but then internally keep the local module separate.
Well, and your comment about it's hard to abstract it, but one of the things I've kind of noticed is that the best way to find when it's not abstract enough is to get other people to start using it, and then you start using other people's stuff, and you realize, like, hey, this is like really hard coded for their organization, and then you fix it. And the more people you have working on it, so it's kind of a release often kind of thing, because then these things get discovered and it's made more generic. And I think a lot of the stuff that, in particular, like Mike has written for RiseUp, once you put it out there, we get patches all the time from people that are like, oh, hey, I'm using this, and I want to add this support for doing something that my infrastructure needs.
I don't really use Puppet, but taking a couple of ideas that came up in the previous talk, I was wondering if it's possible to, with these modules, push them into the the package that they administer and put in a puppet.d directory in that package.
Yeah, kind of like how
you can pick which bits you want to select from that.
Like log check or something like that, where the individual package delivers resources,
And then the maintainer of that package, where they can make major to the configuration files, can maintain the puppet.
Yeah, I'm not sure to do that or to have them move themselves on their own themselves. Or the way at least Ryzeup is using it, I'm kind of curious as to how other people are doing it, but we maintain all our public stuff in a Git repository, and the modules that we are maintaining or we're using from other people and pulling from other people are separate Git submodules. And so that's how we're maintaining it anyway, so it wouldn't be that useful to us, I don't think, to have the things in the Debian packages. I think it's also maybe the wrong place because you don't need them on the deployed system. You need them on the pub master in your repository. So,
I can try to answer that because it's something that the Ubuntu people asked me in Montreal. There is somebody that takes care of the public package for Ubuntu, and he was asking, so there is this bunch of modules out there. I want to package them, because I want Puppet to be more useful out of the box, right? Because out of the box, Puppet doesn't do much. You can follow the little simple things they do, and sorry for this one. So you can configure the, like, I don't know, the host file or whatever, and things like that, and follow those samples and work your way up and write anything from scratch, but that's not very useful. The very useful thing is to work with already existing stuff. The problem is that you don't have the standard set of modules yet. And once we have that, we can create a package that's going to be useful for everybody. But right now, it's still up for debate where that standard package is, or like standard list of modules is, or what it is, or who's managing it, or how we share it, or and all of this. So we at Puppet, as Ryzeup people and others, have started this discussion on how we are going to manage that. And I think eventually one of the goals should be to have a decent package made for that, but I don't think we're or there yet. Answering your earlier question, I forgot to do that, but basically, what Puppet does for us is to have a consistent environment on every server we log into. So we have like 60 servers, and we don't need to install screen for every one of those. We don't need to have like create the systemd users everywhere. Everything is already done for us, and it's consistent everywhere. Find is synced. Nagios is configured, management is configured, so we know where we are, and it's just like as if we were working in a crazy custom distribution, but it's easier to do basically.
I have a comment directly related to that. One thing I've been telling people recently is that it seems as I get older, my memory starts to get worse, and one thing I've really liked about before, and I kind of equate it to in a Harry Potter story, is Dumbledore has this ability to pull thoughts out of his brain and put them in tubes and store them all somewhere and then look at them in here. And that's how I kind of feel about Puppet, is that, like, I used to be able to hold all this stuff in my head, but we have so many services we're maintaining that I can't remember, what config file is what and that sort of thing. And so it's really nice to be able to take all this stuff, write recipes that do all the magic, put that in revision control, and then I don't need to keep it in the working set inside my brain. It can stay there, and then if I need to work on it, I can go there and
Under ideas, I'll put a note saying under, should we start packaging stuff and should we work on policy about what modules we should package? And I think maybe that's possibly one way of approaching that problem of which modules are the standard modules. If we don't wait for the rest of the public community to do that, if we just say, look, these are good things in modules, write a little bit of policy, start throwing modules in, get it wrong a few times, then that might, get the ball rolling.
About that, the Puppet configuration is code, and it's different from most system is that you're treating it like code. You said you put in a Git repository and pull in things from other Git repositories. The nice thing about this is when you're working in a group, you can set up on commit to send an email to the group so you can see what everybody's doing, we'll send a diff, and you can just track all the changes that are going on in your environment. And another thing about this, and you were talking about your own memory managing your infrastructure. And I think that itself is the strongest piece of using a tool like Puppet. When you buy it,
that's really valuable. And to some extent, you're still putting in a lot of effort. You know, in some ways, it might be easier to just go and edit the file on the machine or something. It's more effort to check something out and make changes in a recipe and commit it. But you're gaining all that value that you're talking about.
Yeah, about the packaging of modules, I think I agree about the idea of this early release often to get things going. I'm hesitant to say that I don't know if we're there yet, because I think that on a daily basis I'm making changes to the modules that we're using, committing to our Git repository. If I was installing a package that I wasn't changing in some way, we have to get to the point where we're understanding how we're going to change packages for our infrastructure on a regular basis, or come up with the abstracted module that's abstracted enough so that just installing it and then having the local configurations be something that's changing more regularly. But I don't know if we're quite there yet, but hopefully maybe someone will prove me wrong and package those, because I'm too tied up in trying to upsize my infrastructure and be able to change those things and as well as maintain my package. That'd be great.
But I think if someone does do that, not necessarily me, it's kind of going to force the issue, because it's going to be harder, it's going to be more pain to modify the package. So then you're going to trial a bug report saying, look, I can't extend this. You know, it's not generic enough.
Well, okay. One of the things that happens with modules is that you can have site-specific modules that overwrite the parts of the module. So if it's...
Yes, and I've just done that like a week or two ago.
Right, so there you go. I mean, I think that having that common shared public modules package is a very good idea. I'm not going to use it because I can barely keep up with my own infrastructure and optimizing everything and all this stuff. But I think a lot of people would use it, and they can... people that are interested in working on that can base the packages on the work we're doing. I think that's a great idea. I don't think we should push this away. It's just that I can't really do that in any shape or form. The other thing I like about Puppet is the way it allows you to share best practices. For me, that's the fundamental thing. To be able to version control system administration is a totally new concept that I've never found before. You always have how-tos and descriptions and how to do things and those versions, but the execution of it is always dependent on the system and it's going to interpret like this command line this way of the system, and then he or she's going to fail regularly, and it's going to like the of those instructions are going to vary for the system. So what Puppet allows you to do is to share those best practices, those instructions in code, so that they're formally described and executable by a machine. And then when there's an inconsistency on a certain system, you can port it and say, on that operating system or in that environment, well, it's different. You don't use that yet, use yum or whatever. And so this is a very powerful thing because it allows systems to have more approach their work and start sharing those common best practices, which is something that's very hard to do. It's been traditionally like the black magic system in, like the system in have all this stuff in their head, and once they leave, you're fucked because there's nobody else that can figure out how things work, and maybe they've got some different issue with it, but nobody else understands it. So Puppet allows you to like decentralize that and share it and allow other people to basically review your practices and say, well, that's bad, that's insecure, but that's good, that's a great idea, or I have a better idea for that, and we can improve and share a lot more. It's basically bringing the open source culture to the system.
Another approach to that silo of knowledge in the sysadmin head is not to employ the best. Just employ everyone's.
Yeah, I definitely want to second the bad in the idea of putting your Puppet configuration in version control and then sending out commit notifications. Puppet, they do that, and then Puppet reverts the change, and then it stops working, and then they are forced to deal with Puppet, and that's very valuable right at the beginning. And then having it all in Git, the other thing, and just as a side bonus, is the fact that every single one of our system administrators has a complete backup of our entire machine configuration sitting there in their local Git repository. So if anything ever happens, we have some sort of catastrophic infrastructure failure, we've got, you know, 20 different backup copies floating around, and everyone's hard drive different states can recover state that way.
Are we going to get the painful nightmare of catastrophic failure to put it?
Sure.
I don't want to start right now.
I kind of slightly off topic of this discussion. The question that I would like for people to share how they have done this if they have encountered a similar problem. I was using Puppet to manage 400 nodes cluster where all nodes have to be absolutely bit-by-bit identical. So I consider it a quite expensive operation to manage packages with Puppet because you have to run all the maintainer script and all that stuff, even static file, which takes a lot of time if you want to multiply by 400 or maybe even 5,000, 10,000 computers. It's really a lot of CPU hours. So to do some custom monitor these scripts that are seen from a master from time to time on recursive basis, but it was kind of hackish and I think improvable. So I would like to know if someone had a longer similar situation.
The problem is that if I were going to maintain packages with Puppet over 400 identical nodes, it will take a lot of time for the package manager to update them all. Because it will be like, let's say, 20 minutes multiplied by 400, it's a lot of CPU hours. The nodes were not being used for real work, as opposed to 30 seconds VRC.
Maybe I can try to answer that or understand your question properly. The problem is that when you have a bunch of machines and you need this specific package to install on the machines, it takes time to install the package. So I think that's a problem that you can avoid, basically. If you want to have a dynamic configuration system, you know, you want to be able to install new packages on the fly. So you can't avoid that. There's just no way. I think the only way you can avoid doing that is when you set up a machine, you have a specific set of packages that are installed once when the machine is set up, and then the machine is ready to run. But after that, well, you need to do some upgrades, you need to do some processing, and if the package is taking too much time to upgrade or to process post-install script, well, the problem is in the package, right? That package should be fixed. It's always in DKG or it's somewhere else, but it just does the install for you. And while Puppet is not necessarily very good at performance, maybe we will go back to that later, but I think there is no proper solution to your problem apart from preceding, like starting from an image instead of like starting a base, you can install, then installing Puppet, and then installing all the packages. You can install all the packages and then run Puppet to stabilize configuration as you go along and change your history.
Perhaps one approach would be to say, this is my stable configuration, and when you have a change coming up, you remove servers from the pool of stable servers, tell them that they're now allowed to change, and once they're back to a stable known state, and they're qualified, you make them back into the pool of available cluster nodes, so that the only things that are in the cluster at the time are things that aren't changing, that are in known states. I don't know if that helps you.
Yeah, I think maybe there are a couple different layers of problems maybe that you're running into. One maybe is that Puppet by default is going to just wake up every 30 minutes or so and then run configuration manifest. And if
rise up is that as we've been growing our infrastructure and adding more and more machines, it's almost a thundering herd problem with the Puppet Master that now we have a bunch of machines all hitting the Puppet Master, you know, once every 30 minutes, and that they have those happen at random intervals, but there's still just enough machines hitting it that it's load is starting to be an issue. So those of you that like recipes say like 600 machines or something like that, what kind of things have people done to make this more scalable and work on that problem?
Actually, for that problem, there's a very easy solution because you can load balance via DNS, Puppet Master, and then just replicate your recipe directory.
So yeah,
I've seen it into Puppet Master, and that will scale up.
Maybe finally time for us to
I was going to say, I run the services in an environment where somebody else runs Puppet on my behalf. And as a system administrator, it drives me nuts. They have the thundering herd problem. The solution they've implemented is a large number of Puppet servers and then cron jobs that run at some random time during the day and Puppet you. And it's in a bad loop often enough that I wouldn't recommend it.
I mean, I've talked a lot with the folks, but probably the people who are running your Puppet servers, because we share a lot of the same trouble the Google internal folks and Stanford with the performance problems. We're load balancing across four Puppet servers, and we still have to restart them every 4 hours because they leave memory like a sieve. A few of the things that we found out and talked back and forth with folks at Google. Use Passenger. If you're using Mongrel, you're going to be very sad. If you're using Webrick, you are not scaling to more than 10 systems anyway. So, and then the other is that, you know, with that performance stuff in general, I'm still coming to the conclusion that I wish that it's great that the people who wrote Puppet love Ruby. I wish that it were written something other than Ruby for the fact that Ruby is underlying architecture seems to not handle that kind of scale very well. But Passenger apparently is a huge, huge improvement. And apparently also the latest versions of Puppet are significant improvements on that front.
So about the memory memory leak thing, we've noticed that it happens with source config, so with the connection to MySQL. And we've actually managed to fix that after many, many hours of backporting Rails from Squeeze and some other Ruby stuff, like part of Rails, basically. And nowadays, we used to have a project that we started Mongrel, basically. And nowadays, we have enough time of months on our Ruby setup, on our Ruby Puppet Rails. We use Mongrel, and it actually works, with Nginx for our front end. And we've also done the Trondheim thing. We public clients are very stable for us, so we prefer to run them through the Trondheim, but it's randomized for each client.
Yeah.
So they're not hitting the server all at the same time.
Yeah, we're doing that too. Is anybody running Puppet as a daemon on the client?
Yeah, we are.
I think it's been mentioned that Puppet is improving with every release, and I think the next release is going to be even better. One of the obvious issues with running it constantly as a daemon on your machine is that it's going to just be occupying memory for 30 minutes and wakes up and does something, which to a lot of people is
and Andreas, Steven, and they said that Puppet on the small machines, like embedded hardware, it takes ages. Trying too often will kill all machines. And how could you make Puppet run faster on these ARM, RML, MIPS, SH machines, where it really runs an hour and more, while it goes a minute on the AMD 64? And Andrea still also wants to hint you to use Debian-Enterprise mailing list. And also Gareth comments that at work, he has to restart Puppet Master once a day by Chrome. It is Postgres database connections when using storage stuff, which is really annoying.
I don't really know how to speed up Puppet on an ARM-based machine except to replace it with something more powerful. But the machine itself, it's a Ruby problem. Yeah, it's probably a Ruby problem there. I don't know how to fix that, but maybe 64 machine with a capable amount of resources available to it. It depends completely on what you're trying to do in your manifest, how long it's going to take. 1 minute to apply, compile and apply a manifest on the AMD 64 machine is not that bad, if you ask me. But I've seen compiled manifests and applications on less powerful AMD 64 machines in 20 seconds or less. But I don't really think a minute is a problem, if you ask me. But maybe
if you were saying that was good compared to ARM, it was taking an hour.
Oh, okay. That's understood, yeah.
We had a show of hands of who was doing the daemon, but we have a show of hands who's doing local cryo drops that are spaced or randomized.
So what we're doing is we're running Mongrel and Cron daemon clients, and we had to do all this tweaking. We switched to Messenger. We're using backported Rails and Rake and all this. Other Rails and Ruby stuff is backward packages on the master. Since the upgrade to 0.25, we don't need to restart Puppet Master every hour or so. So that's also very good. And on the client side, we switched away from using the daemon. Apparently, with 0.25, it's much better. You don't need to do that anymore. But I just can't afford risking switching back to the daemon. It's every machine is affected. Like when the Puppet Master fails and eats all memory and crashes, it's just one server. It doesn't matter. The clients keep on working with the existing configuration. And when the clients fail and eat all memory on your server, well, it's all your production server that go down the drain. And that's just something we cannot accept at all. So the only problem we had with cron job based clients is that sometimes the client would hang. On upgrades or like very specific situations where we have like clients that would stop running for some reason, we log into the machine and find that there's a Puppet that's been running for like a month or something like that. We just have to check. That's the only thing we have. Otherwise, we're getting about 60 machines right now and it's working very well.
Well, it would be nice if the clients knew what the load on the server was and could wait to run or something. There was an M-Collect that missed all that.
Yeah, there's a M-Collect that has, you guys should take a look at Google or use your favorite search engine, whatever, to look for M-Collect, which is an interesting, one of the people working on Puppet is working on this, and it has a lot of interesting ways of plugging into Puppet to do things like only run, stagger out Puppet runs on all the clients in a very efficient way, for example. It does a lot of other amazing things. There's a video on the website to check out. But the problem with using MCollect right now is the support in Debian for the ActiveMQ pieces that are needed are really limited, and it's not quite there yet. I haven't really gotten it to work without patching stuff, and I've been forgetting what I did along the way, because there's so much stuff you have to do.
Small comments to all of you who are having memory leaks. It's an active record lab. We just dumped the memory of the processes that were leaking, and it was memory hunted and SQL hunted and so on. So I blame active record, and this will be solved. And the second thing is that if in case you don't know, 0.25 is really, really much faster. They're switched from XML RPC to REST-based something. And
0.26 is even faster.
Yeah, it's 25 or 24 is like another magnitude.
From my IRC, Sorel wonders how do you do a scanning with Puppet?
I can talk a little bit about staging. We give them a lot of thought because we've got a lot of clients who really don't like us to make changes to their systems. Except for the ones they ask us to make, but not stuff where we change a global module and we want to deploy that everywhere. So again, I put it under version control and you can use all sorts of things like regular software release tools that you would normally use for software. So the approach we're going to be taking with that is using Git branches. And basically, whenever we add a new Git branch to our public repository and push it to the server, it creates a new environment on the server so that you can put clients into different environments and they get their own Git branch essentially for that environment. And the way that then what we can do is we can create a stable Git branch and we can create a development Git branch. All of our test systems and our clients' test systems stay on the development branch. We push all our changes to development first. And then it's Git. So if we want to pull something in the stable, we can do a Git cherry pick in the stable. Or more likely what happens is that every 6 months we declare a new stable. Essentially do what Debian does with the release. Do rolling upgrades of all of our clients by just switching their environment to the new stable branch and then continue on development. And that kind of model works great because when you have a version control repository sitting underneath the whole other configuration.
Do you have documentation and scripts for your setup available?
Not yet. That's definitely a goal.
You want to mention best practices?
There is a best practices guide on the wiki. I lost track of kind of where it is at. But.
So we've got about 10 minutes left, and as one of the last things here, I just wanted to make sure that how we move going forward, I want to be able to kind of capture what everybody's doing and try and start working together a little more. Let's see if I can scroll. RiseUp realized that it made more sense for us to start doing things as generic as we could to try and collaborate with other people. So I have a URL here for where RiseUp tracks all our own modules. RiseUp and a bunch of other organizations also got together. And this lower URL here is a site that we have where I guess it's like 5 or 6 different organizations now are trying to collaborate on common public modules and we're using Git for everything. And so these organizations are all contributing to this one place, but then also pulling things back to their own environments. And, several people mentioned the fact that if we can just get kind of the common place to go to start for these things, that becomes the de facto place, and then people can start contributing to it. There's a lot of other examples of this in the community that I think would be good for public modules to follow. If you looked at Nagios Exchange or Unit Exchange or or in programming languages, Perl SCPAN and other things like that. It would be really nice if we had one common place that everybody started when they were looking for things and started trying to use that. I'm not sure where that place is going to be yet. I think right now maybe it's the public wiki. You start by looking there, but it might be nice to have some sort of code repository too and where people host it or give repositories. So what I would like is if people are doing things and are making their Git repositories public, let's try and put it in this document. This document will eventually go on the wiki, and we can start from there. And maybe, and I made a list of things we're doing, and if you see things in there where you're like, oh yeah, that would be useful, we're doing that too, let's get together and try and merge into a common modules and start helping each other out.
From IRC, Lumer, with respect to speed, he wonders if anyone has tried Puppet using Rubinius, which is rubini.us. So?
Sounds like a no.
Second week, last comment regarding Puppet environments and all this stuff. One of the good best practices I discovered the hard way in system then is to deploy things one menu all. That is, when you make a change that's going to affect all your machines, don't do it on all your machines at once. You do it on one machine, then many machine, then all. And it's one, some, many, or whatever. The idea that you do progressively. And there's ways to do that. There's environments you mentioned earlier. There's just doing a configuration on one node. There's various ways to do that. But it's since you're going the best practices way, it imposes you to be more careful in some things. And that is one very key point I wanted to write you.
Any other comments?
So a couple things. Puppet has a construct called case, you know, so you can say put it on in this group of machines on this config, and then you can roll it with multiple switch like he was describing. But the other thing is, as in regards to Rubinius, we haven't run Rubinius yet, but we are doing testing with Ruby Enterprise Edition, and that does gain some performance benefits and memory overhead. I mean, theoretically, it gets about a 30% memory footprint reduction. We're seeing some reduction. It's hard to quantify it because Puppet memory usage varies. The other thing is, I mean, this isn't going to help anybody right away, but it's something to look forward to. There is a group in Japan working on replacing the Ruby memory garbage collector from a generational garbage collector, or it's replacing it with a generational garbage collector. So garbage collection operations will have an increase in performance of over tenfold. So, you know, Ruby itself is largely constrained by the performance of its garbage collector.